Mike Green, I'm here for Real Vision, sitting remotely in Marin County and getting to talk on the other side of the country with one of my good friends, Sri Thiruvadanthai. Nice to see you, Sri.
Nice to see you, Mike.
So now we sat down in New York City at possibly the last possible moment, right before the world shut down for coronavirus. And when we spoke, and that was actually interesting because among other things, the shutdown meant that the editing took a couple of months, took a couple of weeks before it was able to make it out to the viewers. You know, we were watching what was going on. We were seeing markets collapsing. We were seeing the world start to shut down in response to the coronavirus. And we were seeing extraordinary claims around the rates of infection, et cetera. The world's changed very radically since. Right. If you and I were to sit down, if we had sat down knowing what we know now, 6 months ago, 5 months ago, what do you think we would have said differently?
Okay, let me try to answer this in two ways. One thing is the consensus and the speed of the policy reaction. I mean, to some extent, I always think that, you know, in a crisis, people always get their heads together. That said, still, they got it not only right together, but the scale of the intervention, especially in the U.S., has been enormous, right? That's number one. Number two, I would say, is the resiliency of people, which I generally think is always true. Otherwise, human beings wouldn't be surviving. But it's always surprising how much the resiliency there is when you look at the reaction and how people have adjusted to the virus and the second round of renewed resurgence in virus doesn't seem to be evoking the same response, both in the markets as well as among the people.
And so that I would certainly agree with that, particularly the resilience component, right? I mean, people adapt. That's basically the very simple definition of how humans tend to differ from most other animals, right? We adapt to the environment in which we exist. When you think about why people have been so resilient, how much of it do you think has been a function of the idea that this was temporary? That this was a short-term phenomenon?
Well, I don't know. I mean, you know, the thing is actually not seeming to go away. I do think that eventually we will get handle of it, but people adjust to it. You know, I mean, this is what I always think. I mean, looking back 50, 60 years ago before there were vaccines, right? How did people deal with measles or, you know, smallpox or whatever, you know, all those things that were there? It's not like people locked themselves up. I mean, they just dealt with it, which is not to say that we should completely ignore everything and just do what we have to do. But people went about their lives, right? I mean, I think here in the modern world, we have a kind of feeling that we can control everything, right? Mm-hmm. And there are limits to how much we can control. Surely we can control. But this is not how we dealt with 50, 60 years ago. You know, people just went about with their lives.
It's funny because it's not even how we dealt with things 10 years ago, right? So 2009, we had H1N1, I believe, was when H1N1 came through. Similar global mortality rates, radically different response. And to me, the most interesting thing that's happened is the response itself. Right. So I agree with exactly what you're saying. You and I both had a very similar reaction when we saw the speed of the policy response. We were both, I'm certain that, you know, you at the Jerome Levy Institute were involved in discussions with officials. I know I was having conversations with officials and emphasizing the need to rapidly replace the lost income. And we should come back and talk about that in the context of the Kalecki equation. But the broader response in terms of the control dynamics has to me been fascinating. I mean, to see people see the control of their daily lives in the way that they have is a remarkable event. I mean, the fact that we no longer send our children to school, that we moved into a homeschool environment, that we weren't able to go to work, et cetera. We changed so rapidly as a society. I just wonder if we were not, you know, relative to the response 10 years ago that we might have had, I wonder if we've effectively been trained for that.
Right. No, I think that is true. I think part of the thing is the modern society makes coordination possible, but I think there is an element of neurosis also to some extent. I don't want to be a social psychologist here, but, you know, I mean, I think we can think of it in a positive way, that we tend to value life more than we did 50, 60 years ago, right? We are much less cavalier about loss of life. That said, we also think that you know, this is a version of helicopter parenting, and that we can micromanage every single thing, you know, that we can completely control the risks. And there are some risks that are there, and we have to balance the risks with the unseen risks of, you know, of trying to do this complete shutdown, which obviously throws lives of a lot of people. This is especially true in poor countries like India, where, you know, okay, you shut it down, fine. Looking at it from the microscopic 1-2% of the middle-class people who can afford to work from home, but you have tons and tons of millions of migrant workers and things like that whose life was thrown in jeopardy. And poverty is a silent killer. You don't see it directly. You know, mm-hmm. how it's going to affect all these people, their lifetime outcomes, their children, nutrition, you know, malnutrition, all that, we don't know. I mean, yes, there has been some replacement of income, far better than when I was growing up in India. You know, they've done a better job, certainly. But nonetheless, the lives have been thrown off the rails. And how is that going to affect in the longer term is unseen risks that we are not counting, whereas we are counting the lives that we are saving right now.
So why don't we do this? Why don't we split this into two separate components? Because you've written some really interesting stuff talking about the importance of the income replacement. Obviously, right. You know, you and I have talked at length about the dynamics of the Kalecki equation. And so what we've very clearly seen is income or cash flow replacement associated with unemployment insurance. And you put out a tweet the other day that was highlighting that retail sales have actually recovered to levels above where we started the pandemic. But can you expand on that?
So if you look at the retail sales, and especially spending by the bottom 40% or bottom 40 to 50% of the people, it's actually higher than where it was before the pandemic, right? Because what has happened, it's remarkable. We have had this deepest recession and job losses since the Depression, and yet personal income, disposable income, is higher than what it was, right? Because you have replaced, the government has been successful in replacing more than the lost income. I think University of Chicago had a study where they said like 68% of people on unemployment will actually make more money being unemployed than when they were working, right? So, and there are two things this tells you. First of all, the enormous power of the government, fiscal policy. Number two, it's also telling you what happens when you give money to the people who spend most of the money, right? Whose propensity to consume, marginal propensity to use a jargon, is very high. So you're giving it to bottom 50, 40, 50% of the people who tend to anyway spend most of the money. In fact, they have a negative saving rate typically. So you give them money, most of it gets spent. And in fact, JP Morgan Institute had a recent study. They said all this extra $600 per week that people were getting, they were spending nearly 70% of it, and I think that's a low ball estimate. They were probably spending more than 70%.
Yeah.
70% of it. So, you know, I mean, that's where the power of and from the Levy-Kalecki equation, this is what's happening, right? You have the corporate sector, they're cutting wages, right? Normally, most people think it from the micro perspective, think that, okay, cutting wages is good for corporate bottom lines. That is true for an individual firm. But when there's such a large-scale layoffs, what happens is every person's income is another firm's wage is another firm's income because people spend that money, right? So when the corporate sector as a whole cuts employment, it's usually we have recession. We don't have booms. That's not when profits go up because people cut wages, and then you have a vicious cycle of companies then cutting capital spending and so on and so forth. But what we have done is we have neatly cut off that vicious cycle by replacing all that lost income with more than that by government spending. So now all those people can spend going back into the corporate bottom lines, which is why the decline in profits in the second quarter is not going to be nearly as drastic as it would have been had there been nothing. I mean, had there been nothing, profits would have been wiped out in the second quarter. I mean, corporate profits would have been wiped out. Just to give you an idea, if you look at fourth quarter of 2008, when the GDP decline was 8 or 9%, I mean, we had almost like 50% decline in profits, right? I mean, I'm speaking from memory. I might have been wrong on that exact number. But we are not going to get, and we are going to have a 25, 30% decline in GDP. That would mean profits would completely get wiped out. But we have not had that. And you can see the earnings revisions are going up. It's largely because of the replacement of income.
So this is one of the things that we talked about in the paper that I had written, the policy in the world of pandemics, right? That the response was so large and it was coming from the public sector that would naturally flow into the private sector, right? Effectively, we wouldn't know exactly how that would come through. And, you know, a criticism could be leveled saying that, well, only 70% of the stimulus was spent, right? Savings rates have risen dramatically. But as you point out, like, it's probably significantly higher than that for the income constrained. And ironically, because the corporate sector was able to cut wages and able to unemploy people for the most part, you saw simultaneous expansion in the corporate profit component, right? So, and that was particularly concentrated in the larger companies, right? Microsoft, for example, and announcing fantastic earnings, right? So when you think about that dynamic, why not just do that all the time?
Well, that's a good question. And I think this is the question everybody asks, you know, and then a lot of people are assuming that they will do whatever it takes now that we are past some Rubicon and everybody is now an MMTer. I don't think everybody is an MMTer. You know, at the end of the day, it's easy to get consensus on these kind of things when you are faced with an existential crisis. It's hard to get consensus when things are bad, but not as bad. Like, look at right now, how much wrangling there is about extending the unemployment benefits and things like that, right? Maybe push comes to shove, they will do it. I don't know. I mean, I think generally speaking, if you go back even to 2008 and you look at that, was a huge crisis, but the top vote got voted down, right? And the Dow was down 700 points or something like that, you know? So, you know, I think there is an inherent conservatism, let's call it. Conservatism is the wrong word. I don't know. Establishmentarianism is a better word. In doing things the way we have done for some reason. And there's good reasons for it, you know, because those things have worked for 200, 300 years in our case and longer in the UK case, right? So, and, you know, I think we have to be humble to some extent. You know, even though I'm sympathetic to MMT, I come from a very post-Keynesian view. At the same time, there is something to be said for not discarding some conventional wisdoms, even though they may be logically wrong. There might be something beyond our logical framing.
Well, so, and you and I have talked extensively about MMT and the dynamics behind it. I mean, I think we both come to the conclusion that MMT is true, right? It is an accurate description of how the system functions, but it's not prescriptive, right? It doesn't actually tell you what you should do, right? You know, the way that you choose to spend the resources of society, and that's what the government really has, is a claim on the resources of the people who are our citizens and our workers, et cetera. How we choose to reallocate or spend those is important. You know, if we were just to decide to give everybody, you know, season tickets to the Mets, one, you know, 29 out of 30 teams would be disappointed, but it would affect the outcomes that we have as a society, right?
Yeah, I think that is right. I think, see, there are two things. This is a phase change kind of a thing. In the current phase that we have been in for the last 20, 30 years, where globally there is a huge amount of slack, which gets called this global savings glut, which is a very wrong-headed word in my opinion, because it's not the savings that are the driver. But whatever it is, you know, we've had slack and disinflationary, deflationary tendencies over the last 30 years. Right? In that environment, you know, the MMT paradigm is right. Right? There are no real resource constraint to spending. But if you take it to its logical conclusion, and let's say it spend $4 trillion every month, the government does some such number, some huge number, and then we actually take it near the resource constraint frontier at some levels, right? Then the resource constraints start becoming binding. The world changes when the resource constraint starts binding. Then it becomes more like the monetarist world, you know? It no longer is the MMT world. So the question is, how do you manage that world? And a lot of our systems are put in, you know, to manage that kind of a world to some extent. And it is wrong for this kind of the world that we are in. It is true. But when you go to that world, can you easily shift back to doing the policies that are right for that world? And that's the real challenge. And if you go back to the debates in the 60s and 70s, that was really the issue, although it comes from really wrong-headed framing by the monetarists. But the question is, can you easily switch back to anti-inflationary policies when you do that? And there is, that's where the inherent conservatism comes, is because people are afraid of letting the inflation genie out of the bottle. Not because the 70s per se, but even historically, there is a reason for why, you know, what is his name? David Hackett Fisher has this nice book called Price Waves, right?
The Great Wave, yeah. The Great Wave. Phenomenal book.
How inflation has been associated with lots of bad things. Now, I don't think inflation was per se the driver. It is broader social reasons why it was these things happened. But the fact is, the collective societal memory of inflation being associated with bad things is certainly one of the things that puts in place these guardrails.
This also touches in an area that you and I have both researched, right, which is the dynamics of demographics. And so, you know, one of the statistics that I often quote for people is just how different the 20th century was from the 21st century, right? And the example I always give people is at the start of the 20th century, there were roughly 1 billion people in the global labor force. And at the end of the 20th century, there were roughly 5.5 billion people in the global labor force. Over the course of the 21st century, we're going from about 5.5 billion people to, most estimates are, about 6.2 billion people in the global labor force, right? I mean, it's just, it's not even, you can't even attempt to compare the two centuries in terms of the likely outcomes for aggregate demand growth. Right. And so the story of the 20th century, by and large, was one of continuous expansion of the demand frontier. Right. In a variant of Say's law, you expand the labor force. What you're really doing is you're expanding consumption. Right.
Yeah.
If we think about the 21st century, it's very modest growth, much more akin to what populations did in the 19th century, the 18th century, et cetera, where we had real constraints created by disease and, you know, accidents and illness and all sorts of stuff that kept a limit on human population, right? So if you think about what we've done here, we've effectively done something very different than what we did in 2008, right? In 2008, we propped up the production system. We tried to prevent corporations as much as possible from going bankrupt or coming offline by cutting interest rates, et cetera. This time around, we've taken a different approach where we've shifted the demand frontier outward. And this goes directly to your point about the expansion of retail sales, right? We've maintained demand rather than focusing on the supply. And the concern that I have is the decoupling of the United States from China, the decline in global trade that we're experiencing as the U.S. becomes more isolationist in its tendencies, et cetera. Everything I'm seeing actually suggests that we're likely to see an inward shift on the supply frontier at the same time that we're working to maintain the demand frontier. Is that similar to the way you're thinking? I mean, that basically means inflation, right? That is
correct to some extent. You know, see, okay. That is absolutely right. The issue is here, if you go back to trade wars, you know, look at Smoot-Hawley and things like that. Yes, they eventually are inflationary, but the interim process of destruction of demand, because so much of income is linked to those supply, to those global supply chains that we have put in. I mean, even in the US, if you look at it, there is so much thing that goes cross-border, right? And if you start disrupting those things, you're disrupting income a lot, right? Mm-hmm. And if you look at even the US is not actually such an open economy. That said, the beneficiaries of globalization have been people at the top end, right? And if you look at the U.S. has become a much more top-heavy economy, both in terms of balance sheets, wealth, and as well as income inequality, as well as the consumption that is driven by the top, you know, 5%, who account for like 30-35% of discretionary spending. So if you do that, you're going to rattle their incomes and their purchasing power, and the seamless transition from that to the purchasing power of the bottom 40-50% is not as easy. Usually these disruptive processes lead to a disinflationary, deflationary shock before we eventually come past the cusp to an inflationary thing. And I think that's my view. I think we have one more episode of big declines and big deflation eventually before we come to the eventual deglobalization and supply chains coming here. But in the long term sense, I'm not worried, because I think in a long term sense, what it will lead to is more automation. So if you go back to the 50s and 60s in the US, when we didn't have immigration safety wall, because the immigration laws were from 1924 to 65 were really tight. Okay, and we still had a relatively high tariffs, right? And we were a fairly closed economy. What was happening, the Rust Belt actually started in the 50s and 60s. People don't realize it. It started because we were automating our way out of this whole thing in steel towns. That's how it started, right? I mean, you go to Youngstown and, you know, places like that. What happened was we were automating the hell out of our steel industry first. So, in fact, we will have a huge productivity boom as we start automating, which obviously got a backseat when we could. Why automate? Why spend in automation when you can put all your factories up where labor is really cheap?
So actually, you've segued into an area that I had not thought we were going to get into at this point, but I do want to explore this, because, you know, my sense on this, part of the, I talked about this in a podcast, right? My sense is that there's another game afoot, right? That the adaptability that we were talking about at the very beginning, that this could very well be a forced measure to move us to a new system, right? And to your point, we've been through these sort of slow, traumatic adjustments. The rest of the world, as we opened up our borders and we opened up our trading regime, has benefited. So Chinese workers were able to obtain employment and lift themselves out of abject poverty, unfortunately, at the expense of many parts of the United States, right? And so many of those who were involved in this, Paul, I'm blanking on his last name, at the New York Times, Paul Krugman, has done a bit of a mea culpa saying, you know, hey, we were a little bit wrong in terms of our assumptions on how this was going to work, right? That it was going to be seamless and everyone would benefit from quote unquote free trade, right? My sense is that we're in the transition towards the Keynesian 15-hour work week, right? Effectively, the possibilities for our grandchildren from John Maynard Keynes, where everyone can basically survive on 15 hours of work. And then there'll be some of us, you and I think would probably qualify for that, that would be bored out of our minds with a 15-hour work week. And so we're going to figure out other things that we enjoy. And maybe that allows us to push on the you know, potential frontier, the productivity frontier of the economy. But for most people, we're actually kind of discovering that this environment of surplus may be a somewhat permanent state.
If you look at the long history of capitalism, it has always been about, you know, the supply being much more than demand. You know, even Adam Smith wrote about, you know, the degree of specialization is limited by the scope of the market, right? Ultimately, it is the scope of the market. But what happened is we had enough wars and enough things going on that it kept distorting that trend, you know. But the broad trend is towards gluts, and which is why Keynes wrote about it. But he wrote it around during a period of glut, but it is a broader trend. And I think the solution to the glut ultimately is that we don't all have to work, but that's a coordination problem. How do we manage that, right? Because we don't generally as a society like people who are living off other people, you know. Okay, we have given, but I think we have to some extent broken through that somewhat of that inhibition with these huge grants that we are giving, you know. Whether we will completely move toward that, which is everybody works 15 hours a week, you know, and a lot of people get huge grants to maintain a sufficiently decent standard of living so they're not destitute. I think we have moved there, you know, in steps, even since the 1930s, with Social Security first and Medicare and, you know, welfare, and now, you know, even whether you call it basic income or, you know, job guarantee or whatever you want to call it, you know, eventually the progress is there. I think we will get there. And I think in a way, I mean, I don't want to say that many people have not benefited from globalization, but from purely an US-centric view, and I'm very parochial in this, you know, when I'm in India, I'm an Indian, and I'm here in America, and I just only really look at the world from very parochial view lens sometimes, you know, whether it's the US or India. And I think that's all I care about really too much. I don't really care. I'll be very honest about it. And you know, from a US point of view, it has been a giant step backward in many ways. Because, you know, it has set back the investment in automation and things like that, which has been the basis of progress of our society. Because the US starting in the 1800 itself, was a fairly high wage society compared with Europe.
Absolutely.
Because you could live off the land, and and that's why there was always a push towards automation, because you couldn't afford to use cheap labor.
So I have both I have a positive view of that, and I also have a somewhat nefarious view of that, right? I mean, so you're familiar, obviously, with the long recession of the 1870s, right?
Right.
Which in some measures extended from 1871 all the way through the 1930s in a lot of ways, right? Part of me wonders if the dynamic there was actually a labor shortage that needed to be met by forcing people off of their farms, right? And so basically taking people from that self-sufficiency into an environment in which they needed to seek employment. Fascinating series is to compare payroll employment as a fraction of total employment, right? We've seen a collapse in entrepreneurship and business formation as more and more people have moved. Matt Stoller has written a fantastic book, Goliath, right? Which you may disagree with some of the perspective on, but is a wonderful articulation of a way to think about what happened in the 1930s was a fight back against monopoly, a fight back against corporatism, and that the U.S. took a path that was different than the path that was taken in Germany or Italy, which moved towards corporatism and fascism, right? That we interrupted that process. Do you think that maybe we're taking the opposite choice this time relative to the 1930s? I mean, everything that I see indicates that we are becoming more dependent upon the monopolistic entities and their willingness to employ us.
Yes, I mean, there is no doubt. I mean, COVID, in fact, has accelerated that trend, right? I mean, it's destruction of small businesses and even greater expansion Amazon versus retail is obvious, but even in the restaurant, right? Yeah. Who's able to keep operating? It is more the big chains that are able to keep operating, and the small mom and pops are just getting decimated, right? I mean, this is very hard for them to keep operating. I think that corporatism is an issue. And, to be honest, I'm more a consumer of what other people write about. A lot of legal scholars on Twitter have been writing very well about it, apart from Matt Stoller. And, my original insights on that, I mean, I don't think I have a great many original insights, but I do think, yes, we are taking a step back. And, I think maybe something will come out. I don't know what's happening in the legal sphere. I guess something will come out of this, some antitrust and some actions that will eventually reverse some of these trends. I don't know whether it will happen, but I...
I struggle with that, right? I mean, part of the interesting dynamic of the Great Depression was that it was such a break, right? Such a collapse that we ultimately allowed the government sector to expand dramatically. But oddly, we allowed the government sector to expand in a way that constrained the corporate sector, right? Right. So, we ultimately decided that we were going to limit the power of corporations. And in many ways, investments were made to make American society more robust. This is true on a global basis as well, once we're into the recovery process, right? I wonder if by choosing stability this time, right, by choosing to replace the income and allow people to be eased into this, are we going to be so thankful that we can go back to a restaurant that we don't care that it's Panera versus our local Subway shop, right? I'm worried that process of corporatization doesn't get the hiccup that we might have seen last time around.
No, you're right. There is unfortunate or part of the process of change is, to some extent, it is destructive. The more you try to ease it, the less the change you get, right? And another way to think about it is resilience versus stability, right? Resilience is by accommodating change, you build systems that are strong in the long run, right? But we have chosen more towards stability versus resilience. This is like, squelching any small brush fire and setting ourselves up for a huge conflagration, right? And that's what we keep doing. And we had alluded to this discussion in a previous sense too. But, I think the more you do these things, what happens is eventually the social forces come up in ways that you can't predict. It's hard to know. and you know that eventually militate against it. Stability is a metastable equilibrium, in my opinion, and to use an engineering and ecology terminology. What we need is a resilient, stable equilibrium. And the more we do this, and I think then we set up for some bigger problem, maybe in 10 years, 5 years, I don't know. I think, you know, these things, the protests and things like that, they're not completely disconnected from the broader economic forces that are happening as well.
Yeah, no, it's interesting because we've seen these types of forces in the United States before, right? I mean, William McKinley was ostensibly assassinated by an anarchist, right? The dynamics of the Antifa-type protests and the, you know, those percolated for many, many years. You know, much of the action in the Great Depression was actually meant to forestall the forces of socialism and communism that were taking shores in other places. When we think about the impact that this has on the financial markets that you and I are participants in, right? How do you think, I mean, there's a legitimate fundamental interpretation that says, well, if the public sector is going to significantly and permanently expand its subsidy to the American household, that income is going to naturally flow into the large corporations as we're talking about. And so one interpretation of what's transpired is we've seen a significant wealth transfer to the corporate sector, and that should be reflected in higher equity prices. That would be the fundamental interpretation. The technical interpretation that I've offered up is we've supplemented people's wages, and in particular through PPP, we've actually created a cost-plus dynamic associated with employment that has led to a retention of things like 401k contributions, and that money has been flowing into passive vehicles, which has in turn supported markets, as you've heard me talk about ad nauseum. I'm sure everyone's sick of it at this point. How would you weight those two? How do you think about that?
I think that is both are right. You know, so what we are doing is simultaneously, by the wage support programs, indirect, the unemployment benefits is flowing into the corporate bottom line. But the PPP type programs and to the extent these things prevent the layoff of the white collar workers and others like that, right? The 401k, that's where the 401k money comes in. So they're intertwined. And that's why you have the flow dynamic going on. You know, I mean, if you look at 401k, most of the contributions are coming from the top 50%. Right, those are white collar workers, and there is the layoffs are picking up there, but still not big enough. Right, I mean, it's mostly been contained because we did such a successful job of through PPP and through unemployment insurance keeping the economy afloat. Right, so keeping the economy afloat now means that the loss of jobs is mostly in the bottom 50% front facing workers. Right. And those people now, the white collar workers, continue to make their 401k contributions, you know, and they feel good. And then so that's both things are intertwined. And the support to incomes, which flows into corporate profits, also justifies the valuations, right? You know, I mean, look, the valuations can be anything. But the point is, it's harder to justify valuations when profits are falling. It's easier to justify when, you know, cash flow and, oh, they have a positive cash flow. That's good enough. You know, the bar is very low, but you need to at least cross that low bar.
I agree with that. I think actually there's truth in both. And as I said, we've talked about this with our investors and with others. You know, when you think about other areas that are being impacted, right? Let's talk about bond market for a second, right? There's a notable divergence between the behavior of the equity markets and the behavior of the bond markets. What does that tell you? Is there a message there? Because we're seeing, I'm looking at my screen right now, I'm watching rate forwards look much more like the lead into a recession, or, you know, as we're going through a recession, than anything suggesting a V-shaped recovery.
Right. I mean, I think there are two things here. Look, everything is ultimately underpinned by low yields. So this whole 30-year, you know, bond market, I mean, there is no high-yield market before that, you know. There is high yield markets, private equity, you name it, they're all underpinned by it. When the bond bubble, whatever people call it, ends, it'll be the end of all of this, people don't realize it. They somehow think we'll seamlessly go into some inflationary world with all assets doing really well and bonds getting killed. That doesn't happen. That's not going to happen. It will bring the whole thing down before eventually we have a reflationary world. So that's number one. Let me get that out of the way. But here's what I think, right? If you look at portfolios, let's look at the private sector assets relative to GDP. That's really huge, right? Historically elevated. So if you think about the income being produced by those portfolios, which is GDP, broadly proxy for the income being produced by the portfolios, it's low, right? So everybody knows the only justification for these valuations is the low yields, right? But they also know this is an inherently unstable situation, which can be kept on for a long time by cutting rates, which is what we have done, right? So we are near the end of the road in some way. Maybe not, maybe you could extend it for a few more years. But what happens when that road ends is when balance sheets contract, like in Japan or like the Great Depression, it's a deflationary situation. So you want to protect your assets, nominal assets, right? And the only way to do that is bonds or, you know, government treasuries. You know, that's the only way to really do that. There's no other way, or cash, basically, right? And it's very expensive to keep your money in cash because the government wants to, you know, fight you against it, right? So you see a rational response from very wealthy people, or, you know, from large portfolios, to keep cheating up into bonds, you know. And that's why you see people say, okay, what if the Chinese sell? So what? I mean, the Americans are buying it now. That's what is happening right now. It's not the Fed. I mean, if the Fed suppose were to stop buying it, and let's say the yield shot up to 2%, what do you think is going to happen to all the financial markets tomorrow? There'll be mayhem, because every time you have a major spike in bond yields, there is some trouble eventually somewhere in the markets.
Well, I would say there's, so this speaks to a theory that, you know, you've heard me articulate before, that really what's actually happening when the Fed cuts interest rates is not that it's flowing through to the consumption side, right? That we saw that in 2008, right? They cut interest rates and consumption fell. This time around, we've seen them cut interest rates simultaneous to a massive fiscal expansion, and that has supported income, right? So we know that the income comes from the fiscal side, not from the monetary side. My hypothesis is that the support that's being created on the monetary side is actually an expansion of collateral, right? By cutting interest rates, you raise the price of a bond. That expands your purchasing power relative to the rest of your portfolio, right? You're able to use that collateral from the bond to borrow more money. And that to me creates some really interesting dynamics, right? Because one of those is when you cut interest rates, if you have high coupon, long duration assets, right? What that actually does is it creates the conditions where those bonds appreciate massively in price, right? We see this with the Austrian century bond, now over 200, right? So you've doubled the value of that bond and dramatically expanded the amount of money you could borrow against that position to buy equities or to, you know, build a factory or anything else, right?
Right.
When that bond, though, hits a peak in its duration and it begins to move down the curve towards maturity, right, the shape of that price of the bond begins to fall towards par at some point in time.
Right.
And that begins to destroy collateral no matter what the Fed does.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
I'm wondering, you know, a number of people who are very smart have highlighted this dynamic, particularly in municipal bonds and in various other components, where I'm wondering how we think about the risk that the value of the bonds that are in portfolios begins to fall regardless of interest rate policy from here.
Right. That's where we are nearing the end of the game. You know, the interest rate plus QE, you know, and, you know, negative rates, obviously there's pushback. There's only so much you can go, notwithstanding a lot of economists thinking that we can do deeply negative interest rates. You know, IMF has written a paper on it. There are limits to it, and we already see that. There is a lot of pushback. So in a sense, yes, that's where the dynamic of the, what we call it at Levy, the big balance sheet economy, ultimately, you know, meets the denouement, you know, where the culmination of it, whether it happens next year or in a year after that, somewhere along the line, we are nearing that process, I think. Because, you know, the bond collateral is a very good point. You know, see, if you look at historically, and especially true in the last 10 years, is the bond rally during stock market declines have become bigger and bigger, right? Mm-hmm. So providing your portfolio cushion in a 60-40 or something like that. The portfolio cushion is not coming from high yield, but it's coming from treasury bonds, basically, mm-hmm. right? So, and that has become as powerful as it was during the depression, right? So the in between, it was never as strong. And this is a remarkable fact that in this perverse economy where the market goes down, the bond provide the cushion, which then again reflates the market, right? Mm-hmm. But that game can go on only when you are near, when you can, the interest rates have room to fall. And, you know, I think we have another like 150, 60 basis points. You know, we'll go to 50 basis points on the 30 year. And I think that will be the end of the game.
Yeah, I've gone on record as saying, you know, if the Fed were to go negative on interest rates, then that protection in the portfolio is nothing different than a put. It might be cheaper than an equity put, for example, or it might be cheaper than CDS, but you have a negative expected return associated with that, right?
Yes.
That's also true if you get to a point where you can no longer lower the interest rate without going negative, right? So if you get to zero on a 10, for example, or if you get to zero on US rates, if you take those coupons negative, yes, you can inflate the collateral, but as those bonds mature, people have to roll into a negative coupon asset, yes. right? Yes. So it does feel like we are very close to an inflection point in the ability to do this, and not just 60-40 portfolios. Obviously, things like risk parity go with levered portfolios.
Yes.
Right.
Yes. Yes.
What is that? So I agree with you that we are actually looking. We are very close to the point at which the ability to expand the collateral in the portfolio can only be done through the fiscal side, and right. ironically, the recovery in financial assets now has set the stage that we're beginning to, as you use the phrase, conservatism or skepticism maybe on the ability to do this forever. We're naturally drawn to the you know, what I would call the expectations channel. We look at the equity markets and we say, okay, everyone thinks everything's going to be okay. Therefore, we can begin to withdraw support, right? We can cut income to those most affected, most adversely affected, even as we go into a second wave, from $600 a week to $400 a month. If to use the numbers that we quoted before, if 70% of that was being spent, that's an extraordinary collapse in demand.
Yes, yes, this is huge. And in fact, we just wrote a note to our clients yesterday about this, you know, that the expansion of expiration of these the unemployment benefits is a huge wildcard for the markets, right? I mean, that's an enormous amount, because you can see it clearly, right? The bottom 50%, their spending has almost come back to pre-COVID levels, whereas the top 50% hasn't. And that's because, you know, the bottom 50% tends to also spend more on goods, relatively speaking, compared with the top 50%, where there's a lot more services. And, you know, which obviously are constrained by still some restrictions on COVID or the fear. Even if there were no restrictions, people are afraid.
Or the need, right? I mean, services don't have, if I need to replace my car, I can put that off for a period of time. But ultimately, I do have to replace that car.
Yes.
If I don't go out to dinner, I'm not going to then eat two steak dinners at various restaurants the next week, right, to replace that lost meal.
Yeah, so there's no catch-up.
There's no inventory. There's no, you know, bullwhip effect associated with the services economy. And you know, to me, that feels very, very straightforward. When you think about the importance of this, and I would actually just toss on one more piece, which, and this to me speaks to empirical evidence. If you look at the change in PPP from 75%, the requirement to spend 75% on labor, to the seemingly innocuous move to only spend 60% on labor in this last revision, right? Ostensibly buying flexibility for businesses.
Right.
We saw near immediate, it didn't get captured in the June job report, in the daily and weekly data that I track, we saw a near immediate decline in employment, and we saw an almost immediate peaking of interest rates, right? So interest rates have begun to retreat sharply from that event suggesting that deflationary pressures are beginning to mount again, right?
Yes.
You see something similar, I assume.
Yes. You know, in fact, one of our colleagues, his father is a you know, he owns a small business on the side. You know, you can see similar dynamics as play out with the PPP. He had gotten the PPP loan. And it's a natural reaction, right? I mean, you know, you only are going to keep the labor that you need, and you're going to do it as much as needed to qualify, right? I mean, again, you know, so the key thing with any policy, and this is what happened with the TCJA that was passed a couple of years ago, you know, how much of the stimulus is going to people that's going to circulate back into the economy? You know, you can call that velocity or whatever, you know, which I don't like that word velocity too much, but how much
is it going back to
circulation, you know? And that's really the key. You know, if you look at the economy as a whole, if money goes to the bottom 50%, it comes back into circulation very quickly. And that's what drives the inflationary process to some extent. But, you know, if we don't have that, then we have to keep on injecting through fiscal policy. And even the fiscal policy, we blunt it by making all these adjustments, and it doesn't circulate back. You a dollar of deficit spent one way versus another way has very different consequences.
Yeah, this is why you and I are both definitely post-Keynesians, right? Like, we think it actually matters if you do something as silly as paying somebody to dig a hole and then the next person to fill it back in, right?
Yeah.
Like, that's not, yes, you're creating quote-unquote income, but you are destroying the productive capacity of the economy in the process of doing that. When you think about policymakers and their awareness of this, do you think we're going to commit this own goal? Do you think that it feels like the forces are pretty much there to say, yeah, we have to be a little bit more cautious?
I think there is, with the Republicans, mainstream Republicans, not the Trump. Trump would want to get a re-elected, and that's, I don't think he has any particular ideology.
As long as he could sign the check, he'd be happy sending checks to everyone, right? So.
I think there is a lot of skepticism among the Republicans. But that said, they also are facing re-election. The question is, who do they listen to? You know, who are they actually listening to? And, you know, that there's, you know, people don't always get the feedback from everybody. And there is always signals get distorted. You know, that's organizational behavior 101, right? How the signals get channeled back to you through various of your channels, there is always distortions at every level. And, you know, it's not so clear that people necessarily see it the same way. Because a lot of small businesses, you know, they their view is, okay, this is going to make it costly for me to hire people. Right? I mean, which is, I guess, to some extent understandable. But that's the way they see these things. And how do you separate it from their legitimate concerns versus not legitimate concerns versus the genuine need for some people to be actually given more money because they can't really come back to the workforce at this point in time because the jobs are not there versus to incentive to come back to the jobs where the jobs do exist, right? And how do you structure those programs? And those are much harder questions for policy to answer than to extend, you know, $600. Or not to extend $600. And that's why you're seeing these dozens play out. I don't know. I wish I had a crystal ball. I mean, political forecasting is so hard. I don't know what.
I share your concerns there in terms of the ability to make a political forecast. My kids remind me of all the mistakes I've made. The grudging admiration for the ones I've gotten right is very rare and infrequent, but that's, of course, just family dynamics. When you think about the question, though, I mean, this caution, right? Typically, I would argue that the small business person has done extraordinarily well on, you know, the marshmallow test, right? They have deferred gratification, they have made the investment, and so their natural, you know, reaction to this is, well, that's unfair, right? I made those sacrifices. I chose not to have the nice car. I chose not to have the steak dinner. I chose not to have the avocado toast, to use the the language that everybody picked on. And now I'm seeing other people not have to make those choices. So I naturally want to react to that. that happens across class lines.
Right.
But it also happens across ethnic or tribal lines.
Yes. Right?
And so one of the ways that I struggle with how we're handling this is it's easier to decide that we're going to share in communal activities when we all look alike, right?
Yes.
When we all have the same or similar last names, when we have, you know, names, yes, that are some variant of Johan's son, right? Right. You know, it's, and we know what that means because we knew Johan, right? It's very hard to do that in a society in which people see others as other. And I'm wondering, and this is maybe going a little far afield into the sociological framework, but I'm wondering if a blowback is beginning, and if that's really what we're seeing from the Trumpian aspect, right? The blowback against identity politics, the blowback against minority groups, where effectively people begin to say, no, we have finite resources and we therefore can't give this, right? And you're other. Dangerous topic, but I'm interested in your reaction to that.
I'll tell you, and I get a lot of pushback from people on the left. You know, I consider myself more center left, but from an old school, you know, vague liberal kind of frame. Rather,
small L rather than large L. Yeah,
that's a dead dodo right now. Yeah. Dead as a dodo right now. But you know, I see minority identity in politics, as good as safe as it sounds sometimes, is the most dangerous thing, because it leads to majority blowback eventually. I've seen this happen in India, where the majority was never as consolidated as. I mean, the majority is not consolidated here in the US, but at least in the South, you could say it is much more. In India, it was never consolidated, majority calling Hindus, you know, because it's divided among caste, ethnic groups, languages. There are so many. But what you've had is a persistent minority identity in politics shoved in your face over decades, eventually creates a strong majority consolidation, which then the liberals are so surprised. Why is this happening? These guys are fascists. May not be. That's not my point. My point is that you don't realize how much your identity politics creates, in a sense, oh, we are all majority. We are on the same group, which never existed, that kind of an identity. And you can now blame the fascists for fostering this identity. No, your identity politics fostered that. You know, that's one. Or it allowed them to create that, you know, play that field, number one. And when majority identity politics comes in, game over. I mean, it's so dangerous. I can say this as a minority, you know, that's the most dangerous thing. That's why I always feel like whenever this minority identity politics played, I feel like, oh my God, why the hell are these people doing this? You know, you have to appeal. That's why I'm such a big fan of Frederick Douglass and Martin Luther King, because they never appealed to narrow parochial interests. They always appealed to the American creed. And if you look at the what Frederick Douglass said and what Martin Luther King, they actually said, hey, America is not living up to its creed, you know, living up to the ideals, the Declaration of Independence. They harken back to the Declaration, to the Constitution, you know, all that stuff. But the modern movement is very different, right? It is driven by the James Baldwin type of legacy from James Baldwin. That is, fundamentally, the creed is wrong. The creed is evil, right? Fundamentally, it's an evil project. And it's been evil right from the beginning. And then there's no commonality because, see, the average white person, you know, is, so you're saying you're completely denying his entire identity and entire legacy. And that's saying that there's nothing that can be positive that can be taken from it. And where do you leave that person with that? What do you leave that person with?
I can't help. I'm sorry. You've stumped me for a second, because all I can hear as you're talking, it is the Martin Mull 1985, I believe it was called A White History of the United States or something like that, you know, the history of white people or something. And it was a terrible documentary in the form of including many of the actors involved. It was very similar, like the Best in Show sort of, you know, tongue in cheek sort of stuff. But it was actually about exactly this issue, right? That you know, there is a denied heritage associated with the majority group. And it's very, Peter Thiel has his favorite philosopher is a guy by the name of René Girard, whose core credo is what binds the society together is when it takes less violence to preserve the common lies than it would to overturn them, right? And so part of what you're basically saying is we have placed so much effort into tearing down the common lie that we are a good nation, that we are a good people, that the American creed is admirable and desirable, right? We've flipped that around and said that's evil.
Yes. Right?
And so we've lowered the threshold of violence required to tear the fabric of that common law, that common lie, right? This is the Ben Hunt, burn it down, right? Yes. It's just not true anymore, right?
I mean, every nation has to, there is a fiction involved in creating a shared commonality. There is a fiction. The question is, what fiction do we want to create and what we want to perpetuate? And the beauty of Frederick Douglass, if you go through his 4th of July speech, you will see in the end, he appeals to that fiction, right? Whether that is, it's never, you know, oh no, we never lived up to it. They were slaveholders. Yes, sure they were. Of course there was. But, you know, that's also been the lodestar for progress though, right? Whether it was the Civil War, emancipation and civil rights, you know, the lodestar was always that all men are created equal, you know. Mm-hmm. We never lived up to it. But that doesn't matter because it's perfection. You're always going to come up short, but it'll always propel you forward. But if you negate that, what is the thing that we are going to, what is our shared common humanity? And I don't know the answer to that.
I don't know the answer either, but I agree with you. I'm very frightened that we have set the conditions for the majority blowback. And you can feel it, right? It's there. I hope it's not the case. I mean, you've heard me and others have heard me now ad nauseum draw the comparison to the transition from the Roman Republic to the Roman Empire, right? That time period was characterized by the importation of foreign cultures and foreign slaves, most notably the Greeks among them, who brought culture and civilization and encouraged Romans to identify with an other capability, right? Well, the blowback to that were the conservative forces of the Catos and others, right? The Ciceros, who said, no, the Roman values, right? We have to have Roman values. Right. And the process of that blowback ultimately culminated in Octavius Caesar, not Julius Caesar, who literally took control on a platform of, we're going to make Rome great again, right? Yeah. We are going to be express Roman values. He prosecuted his own daughter on that basis, right? So, you know, it does feel like we have set the conditions there. And that I'm very frightened by it.
Yeah, I mean, as I said, you know, I always look for what is a shared vision. If you can't have a shared vision and you even have a conflict about a shared vision, then there is a real problem.
Yeah.
That was the issue with the partition. And in some ways, it's still playing out. What is the shared vision? And we don't have a shared vision. I think all men are created equal. It's a fairly good shared vision. The question is not whether we lived up to it. We never did. That's not the point. But can that be the basis for going forward, you know? But we tear it down and say, oh, we didn't live up to it, you know? So it's useless. It was a lie. Everything is a lie.
Everything is a lie. It's a very deep and true statement, right? Everything, I would phrase it differently. There are simplifications that we make to any statement, right? And if we probe the edges of that, we will find inconsistencies. But if we choose to believe it together, right, yeah, it may be irrelevant that it's a lie. It's when we start to focus on the disagreements. And we see this in, you know, it's unfortunate because we see this magnified across our society. My wife Jen and I have unfortunately seen a far disproportionate number of particularly men in this environment. We've seen a number of suicides amongst, yes, people that we know. And I'm sure that that's a shared experience that we're beginning to see broadly. That type of despair makes it very difficult for people to focus on the positive shared components. And yes. So I don't want to spend too much time on that. Let's talk for a second about another shared fiction, right? And how it plays through, which is the US dollar, right? So as we went into these events, I think most people very clearly saw the crisis of collateral, saw the crisis of credit repayment or solvency. And as a result, the dollar rose rapidly in price because it's the tool that you use to extinguish debts, right? So it rose in value as debts became more onerous. Now we've introduced significant quantities of stimulus, and that stimulus, of course, creates conditions under which the need to extinguish debt, the need to obtain those dollars has become less onerous, and therefore you could argue the dollar has fallen in value. Do you think this is the start of something much bigger in terms of a dollar decline, or do you actually think that you highlighted the risk that we have another deflationary wave? Do you feel like this might be the opportunity for the dollar?
Oh, it's an opportunity for the dollar. I saw that Raul was wavering in his dollar conviction in the morning or yesterday. And I'll tell you something. You know, here is the thing. I've heard this story about Europe and about, you know, the dollar collapse so many times. And whenever something Stephen Roach is writing about it, I know I'm going to take the other side of it. You know, here is a view. There are several fundamental forces apart from the collateral forces. We have given a liquidity salve for a solvency problem, right?
Yes.
But fundamentally, there is a solvency problem because even if you keep corporate profits overall in the aggregate, hold it up, more of it is migrating toward the large firms, which we discussed just a little while. So what you are having is the bigger become richer, becoming richer, you know, and the more of the leveraged entities are going to see decline in profits, making more of them bankrupt, essentially insolvent, right? So that's one aspect of it. The second aspect of it is, if you look at it globally, right, if you look at the private sector balance sheets, I never look at public sector balance sheets because the public sector is a stabilizing force, not for EMs, but for the
true fiat.
And if you look at the private debt to GDP ratio, it's higher across the world outside of the US than it was in 2008, even in Europe, right? That's number one. And number two, if you look at bank balance sheet size relative to GDP, it's still much higher in Europe. So what that means is if you're going to have a private sector debt problem and banks are going to get into trouble, it's going to put tremendous pressure on sovereigns, which we saw in 2010. That was a problem with the sovereign debt crisis in Europe. The scale of coordination that would be needed in Europe to tackle that kind of a thing, they're nowhere close to that. Yes, they took some steps, baby steps, but let's be very clear, these are baby steps. They're not even they have not even gone from Articles of Confederation to the Constitution. Okay, they have not sublimated their individual sovereign status yet. Okay, forget about actually creating a national debt. Yes, they have taken some baby steps, but we are talking about trillions and trillions of dollars to solve the problem. And they're haggling over $700 billion over like 4 years or 5 years. I mean, they're never going to get that done, in my view. That's number one. Number two, you have fundamentally, again, you're coming back to the issue of where is the net demand? We are a demand short world, and the world is not doing enough fiscal stimulus. Our fiscal stimulus is actually the biggest, and so which means we are going to come out of it eventually when COVID goes away much better shape than everybody else in terms of growth and GDP and growth. Right now, we don't look so good because Europe has gotten its COVID under better control than we have, but eventually we'll come out of this. That's the second thing. And the third thing is the EMs, right? If you look at them, their model is dumb in so far as exporting and being the export factories for the rest of the world, for the developed markets, right? So the question is creating domestic demand, and they are nowhere near it, right? Which is Matt Klein and Michael Pettis's book, you know, so you can see that. And that fundamental problem is there in all EMs, right? And what is Europe? Europe is a leveraged bet on EMs because what has Europe done in the last 10 years? How have they gotten out of the sovereign debt crisis? By running a big current account surplus. That's what they have done, right? That's how they've gotten out of it. So, but that's now a vulnerability because they have been exporting a lot. I mean, people tell you, oh no, all the exports are within the Eurozone, but the current account surplus for the Euro area as a whole is with the rest of the world. And that is going to evaporate. And what is the solution to that? Can they do the kind of fiscal policy we do? 2 trillion, 3 trillion, can they do that? No, I don't think they will do it. No matter what other people think about it, I don't think they will do it. And their whole edifice, they have taken baby steps and they have taken some important steps. Yes, I would not say that they are not important steps. Baby steps are important steps too. And they have also done some bank retrenchment over the last 10 years. So they are not as bad as they were in 2008, but nothing compared to where we are in terms of bank vulnerability, bank capital shortfall in the event of a crisis and stress scenario. Nowhere close to that. So there is a lot of repair around the world to be done. And this is a damaging crisis, solvency crisis. So the dollar is going to rise again.
Yeah, I come to the same conclusion. I see this as the opportunity as well. Certainly no guarantee that it doesn't go modestly lower, but it does feel, you know, I am hearing those same rumblings, right? Well, maybe Europe is the strong money, you know, environment. Well, it doesn't matter because the only people that have European debts, Euro type debts, are those who are either in the Euro community or on the periphery, right? The rest of the world, this is where Brent Johnson's milkshake, you know, theory dynamic, he's absolutely correct. As long as the U.S. is able to enforce the collection of debts on a global basis, which until it's not the world's hegemon, you know, is difficult to imagine. But as long as that's the case, it strikes me that you are going to see that collapse in income, that collapse in the ability to service it. If I think about EMs, and you and I both have a very dire view of EMs, right, which is, you know, this general idea that the way that you rise in wealth is by providing labor to the rest of the world where they are willing to buy the services that you produce, the goods and services in excess of your domestic consumption, right? That allows an upgrading of an EM. If we move to a US-centric automation environment, well, that is very difficult for many in the US who will lose jobs as we go through this process of automation and consolidation. It feels so magnified to me in the rest of the world.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. I mean, I completely agree with you. I'm not disagreeing. They're not shaking in the mm-hmm. At the end of this whole period of globalization, EMs have not used it to create a domestic durable consumer base, right? Mm-hmm. That's really the problem. And you see that in one form or the other. Yes, China has some consumer base because, you know, it's grown so much, but it's not enough to make up a sustaining, self-sustaining domestic demand-based economy. There are very few self-sustaining domestic demand-based economy. They happen to be all Anglo-Saxon economies. You know, they are, for some reason, for whatever reasons, I don't want to be making ethnic statement here, but, you know, the U.S. is one of them. I mean, the EMs, you know, the part of the problem is income inequality has increased in the EMs dramatically. Right. So what has happened is, even as you have created tremendous growth, you have not created the self-sustaining demand. And the problem in EMs is a lot of the elite tend to consume things that do not create demand in their own societies. Right. Like, for instance, they want to get an upper education in the U.S. I mean, that may go away now without visa things, but they get the higher education in the U.S. Right. That's mm-hmm. one. They take vacations in Europe. Right. Or they buy, you know, Rolls Royce or Lamborghinis or whatever it is. So they are not creating domestic demand, right? So that's a big problem. And so you combine that with a situation where you are taking away the marginal moving the person from rural to a factory servicing Western customers. You know, that process, you take it away, you're left with nothing. You're left with nothing. And that's really the problem. And they need to find a way to create durable mass demand domestically, which the West has solved long back in one way or the other. They solved it. You know, that's a complex issue, but they solved it.
Well, I would cautiously interpret that and say that we found a solution, whether that turns to be a globalized solution, not meaning global as in worldwide, but instead of a universal solution rather than a localized solution.
Yeah.
To me is a little unclear, right? So the risk is that we destabilize ourselves and in the process make the world much worse. Well, this is a pretty dark discussion. What do you see that is positive?
I see the U.S. ultimately as a positive, because ultimately, whether it is not complete deglobalization, whatever the process is, will eventually be good for productivity. We won't get manufacturing jobs back, but we'll get manufacturing back, and that will create the back-end jobs related with the automation process. And that's a human progress, which I think is important. And I also think, coming out of this, these things, we people are slowly recognizing the importance of creating more, whether social safety nets or whether, you know, more durable income distribution in a way that, that creates domestic demand. And I think in the US, we have experience with dealing with these things. We have had these issues. You know, sometimes they were pretty bad, but we come out of it eventually because our systems are resilient enough that we will come out of it. Notwithstanding our dire social commentary earlier, I feel like somehow we will come out of it. And I think there is, you know, if you talk to the younger generation in particular, there is a lot more shared vision among the younger people in the U.S. You know, my sons, you know, and I feel like there is better hope there. The EMs, I don't know. And Europe, I don't know. I don't know the answer to Europe. And I feel like this is the moment of truth for EMs, like just the Asian crisis, you know, the 1980s was for the Latin American countries, and they never really recovered from it to a large extent. You know, the catch up, Mexico has not caught up to the US in 40 years. All the catch up from 1945 to 70, they've done nothing in the last 40 years. Yeah. And you know, I'm this is the moment of truth. Can they come out of this? You know, can they come out of this with, and that's a political question. I don't know the answer. I hope I'm always optimist on India. I hope they come out of it, you know, but that's where it is.
Well, the challenges I see for India is that the path that has worked for the Asian tigers, right, is not right. Open to them, right? Yes. That is not a path that is available. And so they'll have to figure or discover an alternate solution to it. And that's challenging, right?
Yeah.
I share your optimism, by the way. I mean, people have heard me say this before, that, you know, it's very simple to draw the analogy between America and the Roman Empire and say that the fall is going to come because of extraordinary inflation and, you know, we're going to lose our power. I think we haven't begun the empire yet. I think we're in the transition. And so, you know, we have the greatness of Marcus Aurelius and the goodness of Trajan ahead of us.
Yeah.
But there's probably a very painful transition on the way.
Yeah, there is a transition on the way. There is a valley. But on the other side, I think U.S. has, you know, favorable demographics, you know, and we know how to deal with these things. Eventually, the system knows, you know, the system is resilient. You know, it survived civil war, it survived depression, you know, it survived all these things. And it's got enough in it to come out of it.
I hope you're right. I think ultimately Churchill's expression, you know, the Americans will do the right thing after they've exhausted all of the potential other potential options. I still believe that holds true. I hope it's correct. I'm concerned. I think that there are, you know, the fact that it happened in the past doesn't mean it's going to happen now. But I do think you're right that the net positives associated with us, with the U.S. are, barring significantly unforeseen consequences, situations are likely to bear fruit. Well, listen, Sri, can we do this again as always, as we always do? We've speculated on the goodness of Trajan and the greatness of Marcus Aurelius. Can we revisit this in 130 years? Is that
yes, we'll all live so long.
So if we can't make it a promise for 130 years, let's try to make sure that we do this again in 3 to 6 months. I would really enjoy the opportunity, as I always do. And it's great to see you. And look forward to being able to see you in person again soon.
Yeah, same here.
All right. Take care, Sri.
Take care.
If you're ready to go beyond the interview, make sure you visit realvision.com, where you can try Real Vision Plus for 30 days for just $1. We'll see you next time right here on Real Vision.